Dear viewers of Akshay.com, by Vetri from Pondicherry. Good evening. Today, I am going to cover the next unit, the most important unit in the inorganic point of view, hydrogen. Hydrogen is the most, one among the most abundant element they are. So today, I am going to discuss what are the isotopes of hydrogen, how to prepare, what are the reactions, and if time possible, hydrates of compounds also I will discuss. So first let me discuss about the occurrence. Dihydrogen is the most abundant element. So I am using dihydrogen is the most abundant element in the universe. Another interesting information is, hydrogen is the common element in Jupiter and Saturn. It is what is covered. It is the common element in Jupiter and Saturn. So this hydrogen was discovered by Henry Cavendish. First person identified hydrogen. This hydrogen exists in two forms, namely orthohydrogen and with parallel spins, and para-hydrogen with anti-parallel spins. This is the interesting information regarding occurrence. Coming for the position of hydrogen, what is the position? The atomic number of hydrogen is 1. So automatically it is the first element in the periodic table. Hydrogen is the first element in the periodic table and it has 1s1 electronic configuration. So based on the electronic configuration, so if you want to write for hydrogen, it is 1s1. We have already discussed under the periodic table. So based on the electronic configurations, it belongs to S block elements. Kindly follow. It belongs to S block elements. What are S block elements? Alkali and alkaline earth metals are called S block elements. So the hydrogen, based on electronic configuration, we can place in one first group, that is alkali metals, but the only hydrogen is the non-metal. All the remaining, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, and francium, all metals. Right. So the other interesting information regarding question is, it resembles like alkali metals as well as the halogen group. So it can be, if you want to fix the position of hydrogen, it can be placed in first group, as well as placed in the halogen group, that is the 17th group. What is the reason? Let me explain a few examples. That is, like alkali metals, like lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, etc., it is having electronic configuration of NS1. So hydrogen is 1s1, lithium 2s1, sodium 3s1 is going on. So based on electronic configuration, it resembles alkali metals. Number 2, it is having a valency of 1. Like alkali metals. Oxidation state plus 1 like other alkali metals. This is the very interesting information. So it is resembles alkali metals. And in some, based on some property, it also resembles halides. What way? By accepting one electron, you will complete the octet. Say for example, you take the electron of the hydrogen, 1s1. By addition of one electron, it will complete 1s2, that is, it will resemble the nearest stable electronic configuration of helium, like other halogen. Fluorine, by accepting one electron, resembles neon. Chlorine, argon, like that. So it resembles the, based on these electronic configuration, the halides. Another most interesting information compared to the halogens, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, is it is also having -1 valency, hydride, negative valency, like -1 for fluoride, chloride, bromide, etc. Because it will combine with metal to form hydride, lithium hydride. So lithium hydride, it is negative, -1. This is an interesting. So like other halogen, so it will, all halogen will combine with lithium or other metal to form lithium halides. So hydrogen also combined like that because it is having -1. So because of these properties, so now it can be placed either in first group first group or into 17th group halogen. This is the interesting information regarding the positions. Okay, let me go over the next one. The most important information is isotopes of hydrogen. That is the most important. So first, before entering into the preparations, let me discuss what is isotope. Elements having same atomic number but different mass numbers are called isotope. Very, very interesting definition. Same atomic number, mass number, if it is different, we'll call it as isotope. So in the case of hydrogen, there are three isotopes are there. One is, we call it as protium. Protium. The atomic number always has the open-ended one, mass number is one. So simply that is nothing but we are calling normally as hydrogen. 1, 1, 1, H1. So atomic number 1, mass number 1. So here atomic number 1, mass number 1, and so proton is, there is no neutron in the protium, that is hydrogen. The another interesting information is, in the percentage, if you calculate the occurrence, it is 99.984% of protium will be there. Only the remaining will be other isotopes. Right. The second isotope, it is a deuterium, or another name is heavy hydrogen. We can represent by this, that is 1H2, atomic number 1, mass number 2, so usually represented by capital D, deuterium. As usual, atomic number is 1, mass number 2, kindly follow, that is the main difference. So automatically proton is 1, the only difference here it is, neutron in the case of protium 0, in this case one neutron. And the percentage of abundance, if you go there, the total percentage, so it is 0.016, that is the percentage. Very, very, very less comparative isotope. The third isotope, it is called tritium. Tritium is the isotope, again usually represented by 1H3. Atomic number 1, mass number 3, usually represented by capital T, tritium. Okay, atomic number 1, mass number 3, as usual, based on atomic number, so proton 1, but neutron 2. The percentage abundance very, very, very less, that is 10th of power of minus 15, very, very low. So this is the interesting information regarding isotopes of hydrogen. So there are three isotopes. Protium, deuterium, and tritium. So, question can be asked, kindly follow. So, let me go for the preparation of dihydrogen. So, hereafter, instead of saying protium, I will use hydrogen means dihydrogen, that is protium. Okay. So, first let me discuss laboratory method. In the laboratory, how we can prepare hydrogen gas, that is protium, dihydrogen. So, normally, when you add dilute HCl to the metal zinc metal, hydrogen gas will be liberated. So, zinc chloride is forming, hydrogen gas will be liberated. This is the laboratory method. We can easily prepare and collect hydrogen gas. So, zinc nanowires and simply dilute HCl, immediately hydrogen gas will be liberated. You collect and keep. That is the simplest method of preparing, laboratory method of preparing dihydrogen. So, another interesting method is, so same metal zinc, but instead of acid, now we can use two moles of sodium hydroxide. So zinc reacts with sodium hydroxide to produce sodium zincate, and again hydrogen gas will be liberated. So either by acid, dilute acid, or by sodium hydroxide, zinc metal produces hydrogen. This is the interesting information. So both methods we can apply in the laboratory to prepare hydrogen gas. Okay, let me go further methods. Commercial method, large scale, industrial method. So if you want to produce large amount of hydrogen gas commercially, these are the following methods. Number one, electrolysis of using acidified water. So take water and electrolysis, but in place of acid medium, so using that is platinum. So when hydrogen water, if it is pass electric current, will decompose to produce H2 gas and O2 gas. So automatically from this we can separate H2 gas. That is during electrolysis, again H2 gas are collected separately, O2 gas collected separately. So we can collect commercially hydrogen gas by this method. The method is called electrolysis using acidified water. Very, very interesting preparation method.
The another method is electrolysis using aqueous barium hydroxide. So instead of water, simple water, you will take barium hydroxide solution, but in this case use nickel electrode. So in presence of the nickel electrode, if you pass electric current, barium hydroxide will decompose to produce hydrogen gas. This is the highest purity, 99.95% of hydrogen gas will be liberated. You can collect and keep. This is commercially most important information. Okay. Next method. Electrolysis of brine solution. That is not sodium chloride. Again, electrolysis of brine solution. So sodium chloride, aqueous, to pass electric current, you will get sodium hydroxide, you will get chlorine gas, you will get hydrogen gas in two different electrodes. So collect hydrogen gas separately. This is another important commercial method. So electrolysis of brine solution. The next method is action of steam on coke or hydrocarbon. Simple coke you can add action, pass steam, or any hydrocarbon also you can pass steam. You will get the finally a corresponding hydrogen gas along with carbon monoxide. So from that we can separate. The general formula here it is, I am using CnH2n plus 2 plus NH2O. At a higher temperature nickel, it undergoes, it produces a water gas. Water gas nothing but a mixture of carbon monoxide and hydrogen, 1:3 ratio. That is nothing but water gas. From the water gas, we can separate hydrogen gas commercially. This is simple. So the specific example here I have quoted methane. Methane reacts with water to produce at 1270 degree in presence of nickel catalyst. So it produces water gas, that is CO and H2 gas. 1 mole of CO gas and 3 moles of H2 gas. This picture we are calling it as water gas. Kindly follow some time. Question can be, what is water gas? It is nothing but a mixture of carbon monoxide and hydrogen. So these are the methods we can go for commercially. Now coming for the properties. So I have discussed so far, preparation I have discussed. Now let me go for properties. So properties means I can classify into one of the physical property and the chemical property. Under the physical properties, let me discuss. It is, hydrogen is a colorless, odorless, tasteless, combustible gas. Kindly follow. It is colorless, there is no color. It is odorless, there is no odor. Tasteless, but highly catch fire immediately, combustible gas. This is the important property, physical property. Another interesting information is, it is lighter than air. And if you pass into water, it is insoluble in water. Kindly follow. This is an interesting information. So it is lighter than the air and insoluble in water. These are the physical properties. Now let me go for the chemical properties. So under the chemical properties, now I want to discuss the following. That is, because of its electronic configuration, I have already pointed out atomic number 1. So 1s1 is the electronic configuration. So 1s1 means on single unpaired electron, so highly reactive. So that it does combine with almost all the elements. Almost all the elements combine because it is highly reactive unpaired electron. So these reactions, chemical properties, I am going to discuss under the following heading. One is action of non-metals. So what made hydrogen react with non-metals? The second type, action of metals, I will discuss. What way it will react with metals? And thirdly, what way it will react with compounds. So I am going to discuss all the reactions under the chemical properties, action of non-metals, action of metals, and action of compounds. Let me go one by one. First, let me take action of non-metal. What will be non-metal automatically? Even the first class I have discussed, metal, non-metals, and metalloids. So, mainly non-metals, you know, we have come across already p-block elements. So first reaction here I am taking non-metal is action of oxygen. So hydrogen, 2 moles, react with 1 mole of oxygen gas at higher temperature produce water. Very, very interesting. It is an exothermic reaction. The delta H value minus 285.9 kilojoule per mole. It is a very, very interesting. So this is action of oxygen. Next one is action of nitrogen, so producing ammonia gas. This is very interesting. So 3 moles of hydrogen gas reacts with 1 mole of N2 gas at very high temperature, that is 673 Kelvin at 200 atmosphere in presence of iron, ammonia produced. That is, this is actually Haber process, we call it as synthesis of ammonia. Again, it is also an exothermic process, delta H value equal to minus 98.6 kilojoule per mole. So this is action of nitrogen. Same way, hydrogen also reacts with the halogen, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, but in different manner. The final product will be always hydrogen halides. So 1 mole of hydrogen reacts with 1 mole of X2. X2 indicates nothing but maybe fluorine, chlorine, bromine and iodine. So produces 2 moles of HX gas. And the interesting information here it is, fluorine is the more reactive element among the halogens. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine and iodine. So fluorine is the most reactive element. And it reacts even in dark with the hydrogen. So it is the, even in dark, fluorine reacts. But when you go for chlorine, bromine, only in presence of light it will react. But when you go for iodine, it requires a catalyst. It's very, very less reactive, so it requires catalyst. This is the interesting information regarding halogen. Okay, let me go for the next one. Coming for action of metals. There is hydrogen with many metals, it combines at a high temperature to yield the corresponding hydrides. This is the most important information. So hydrogen combines with all metals at a higher temperature to produce corresponding hydrides. Suppose generally, let me take first group elements, first group metal, lithium. So lithium means lithium combines with hydrogen to produce lithium hydride. So this is the equations. Kindly follow. The interesting information here it is automatically the correspondingly the, this is the equation equal. So this is the general form. So this is the specific form. So 2 moles of lithium reacts with 1 mole of hydrogen to produce 2 moles of lithium hydride. So with any metals it reacts to produce corresponding hydride. If it is the corresponding alkaline earth metal second group, the corresponding the formula will change. That's all. The only difference. So always, so this is the most important. Hydrogen always reacts with metal to produce corresponding hydrides. Okay, let me go to the next one. Action of compound. So hydrogen also reacts with the compound in a different way. So let me classify compound in this way. That is inorganic compound and organic compound. First, let me take action of inorganic compound. So, it reduces some metal ions in aqueous solution. Generally, hydrogen is used as a reducing, the corresponding, you know, powerful reducing agent. So, it reduces some metal ions in aqueous solution. And also, oxides of metal also it reduces. Can you follow? Into the corresponding metals. The specific example here I am taking, that is palladium chloride. That is, reacts with H2 gas to produce palladium. So it undergoes reduction to produce a pure metal palladium solid to SL gas. So for this, specifically, this is the general formula we can write. Metal, pure metal. The next one, action of organic compounds. Organic compound, you know, specific example, methane, ethane, ethylene, these are the specific example. You might have studied already in a 10th. So, hydrogen reacts with many organic compounds in the presence of catalyst to give useful hydrogenated products of commercial importance. This is the interesting information. So, it reacts with many organic compounds in the presence of catalyst to give useful hydrogenated products of commercial importance. A specific example, vegetable oil. All vegetable oil, if you take and if you pass hydrogen in the presence of nickel, a ghee, vanaspati ghee, a solid form, will be obtained. More specifically, if you want to specify, olefins, alkenes, olefin, nothing but alkenes. Alkenes. The first member is ethylene, second member propylene, like that. So, olefins,
reacts with the hydrogen plus of nickel, produces corresponding alkane. So alkene will be converted into alkane in presence of hydrogen and nickel. It is called hydrogenation. This process is called hydrogenation. Another interesting information also is there. Normally, we'll use the commercial point of view, hardening of oil. Oils, this vegetable oil, oils can be converted into solid form. We'll call it as hardening of oil by passing hydrogen gas. This is the interesting information. Under the organic compound, okay. So, hydroformylation of olefins. So, in some cases, hydrogen in presence of carbon monoxide will add a formaldehyde group to the corresponding alkyl part. In this specific example, general formula, RCH double bond CH2 is an alkene, general formula. R can be anything, it may be H, it may be CH3, anything. So when you treat with 1 mole of H2 and 1 mole of CO, the corresponding aldehyde is formed. So, formation of aldehyde from alkene is called formylation of olefin. Hydroformylation of olefin, you call it as. The next step, what will happen? Excess hydrogen will convert again, reduce aldehyde to corresponding alcohol. So, aldehyde will be converted into alcohol. So, when you are coming for plus 2 level, you will be studying this. This is the interesting information. Aldehyde and ketone will undergo reduction to produce corresponding alcohols. Aldehyde will give primary alcohol. Ketone will give secondary alcohol, that you will study. So, in this case, hydroformylation of olefins. So, hydrogen in presence of carbon monoxide convert any alkene into corresponding aldehyde can finally to alcohol. This is called hydroformylation of olefins. Now, with this, now let me go for uses of dihydrogen, that is hydrogen. A number of uses are given. So, I have start this study here. The first one, most important, it is useful for the preparation of nitrogen containing compounds. Very, very useful this. What is the nitrogen containing compounds? It is very useful to prepare ammonia, nitric acid and nitrogen fertilizers. All these compounds containing hydrogen. So this is the number one. And again, just now I have informed you, it is also useful to prepare vanaspati by passing hydrogen to vegetable oil. And again, the laboratory method, methanol, CH3OH, methanol can be prepared by using hydrogen. And I have already discussed metal hydrides, general formula MHN. Metal hydrides can be prepared by using hydrogen. And HCl, the most commercially available, we are using for as a reagent for the laboratory, can also be prepared with the help of hydrogen. And in all metallurgy, extraction of metals from ore and minerals, so we are using hydrogen for reduction. So hydrogen we are using more uses in the metallurgy. Another interesting information is for cutting and welding also we are using hydrogen. Right. The most important among them all is it is used as a rocket fuel we are using. We are using the liquid hydrogen we are using for rocket fuel. And also, it is used as a fuel cell. So, this is the most important interesting information. So, actually, during this Apollo program in India, so we are using this cell that is called fuel cell. So, hydrogen we are using. So, these are the main importance of uses of a hydrogen. With this, let me go for the next one. So, with this hydrogen idea, let me enter into hydrides. What is hydrides? Very simple. Any element combined with the hydrogen to form hydrides. Very simple. So, dihydrogen under suitable conditions combines with almost all elements except to noble gases. Noble gas nothing but inert gas element, 18th group. Helium, neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon. So these group elements, inert gas group, they are chemically inert. So except these elements, all elements will combine with the hydrogen. So dihydrogen under suitable condition combined with almost all elements to form binary compound called hydrides. Binary means the compound containing only two elements, two different elements.
So let me represent by general formula. E indicates an element. E indicates an element. Plus one mole of hydrogen, the product with EHX. Or I can use the term EMHN. Depending upon the valence of the element, the proportion vary. This is the general formula. So we are getting generally this is the hydrides. The next one. So when you say hydrides, I can classify entire hydride into three types. What way? Number one, ionic hydrides or saline hydrides or salt-like hydrides. This is the type one. Ionic, all metal hydrides we are calling as ionic hydrides. Saline or salt-like hydrides. Number two, covalent hydrides or molecular hydrides. Non-metal generally will combine with this to form that. And another is metallic or non-stoichiometric hydrides. This is another interesting hydrides. So let me discuss one by one. First one, ionic or saline hydrides. Most of the S block element, kindly follow, only S block. S block means there is S1, S2, that is alkali metals, alkaline earth metal, these two groups, first group and second groups are called S block elements. So a metal present these S block elements generally form ionic or saline hydride with the dihydrogen. So the general representation is M plus H2 gives MH or MH2. Suppose if it is a first group metal, M plus H2 gives MH. In that case, now I will add 2M here. Suppose if it is a second group metal, so M plus H2 gives MH2 automatically. This is the formula. Very, very interesting. So this is for first group, this is for second group elements, second group metals. So these hydrides that are formed, we'll call it as ionic or saline hydride. So elements that is formed from first group or second group metals are called ionic or saline hydride. This is the most important information. So coming for this, from further informations, these ionic hydrides are crystalline, non-volatile and non-conducting in solid state. Very, very interesting property. So these ionic hydrides formed from first group or second group elements are crystalline in nature, non-volatile and non-conducting in solid, even solid state, it is a bad conductor. However, in molten state, they conduct electricity. However, in molten state, they conduct electricity. Because in molten state, now it will conduct electricity. So this is the interesting information. So actually, when you are discussing in a, when you come for plus 2 level, they are under the electrochemistry, we are studying these conductor, different types of conductors. This is coming under the semiconductors. Okay, now, on electrolysis, they liberate hydrogen gas at anode. Very, very interesting information. So, these hydrides, metallic hydrides, formed from first group, second group elements, so, on electrolysis, hydrogen will be liberated. Gases, hydrogen gas will be liberated. This is the important information. Next one. Coming for the chemical properties regarding this. Saline hydrides, ionic hydrides or saline hydrides react violently with water producing dihydrogen gas. Just now we have seen. A specific example, sodium hydride reacts with H2O giving sodium hydroxide and hydrogen gas liberated. This is the interesting information. Violently, it reacts violently. But since lithium hydride is less reactive at a moderate temperature with oxygen or chlorine, they are used as synthetic organic reagent. Another most important information. When you go for higher level, MSc level or MPhil or PhD level, in the laboratory we are going synthesizing a number of organic compounds. For that, we are using the more famous synthetic reagent is lithium aluminium hydride, LiAlH4. Lithium aluminium hydride and lithium borohydride, LiBH4. So these reagents we can prepare from hydrogen. So these hydrides coming under this. So this is the most important
They are called synthetic organic reagents. So fairly specifically, how we are preparing this here? Simply, lithium hydride reacts with aluminium, that is correspondingly chloride, gamma, to produce lithium aluminium hydride and lithium chloride. This is the same way, lithium hydride reacts with borane, diborane, P2H6 to produce lithium borohydride. These are all synthetic organic reagents. We are using normally effective releasing agent, kindly follow. So this is the important information regarding the chemical properties. Next, let me discuss covalent or molecular hydrides. Second type, covalent or molecular hydrides. Most of the P-block element, kindly follow, most of the P-block element form molecular hydrides with the hydrogen. P-block means it is starting from that the first two, the first group, second group, S block, the remaining 10, D block, and the 13th onwards, 18th, it is P block. So most of the P block elements form molecular hydrogen with hydrogen. The general representation is E plus H2 gives EHN. Right. Example, methane, NH3 ammonia, water, HFR, specific examples of hydride, covalent hydrides. So methane nothing but hydrides of carbon. Ammonia nothing but hydrides of nitrogen. Water nothing but hydrides of oxygen. And HF nothing but hydrides of fluorine. So this is the very good information for this molecular, that is covalent hydride. Now this molecular hydrides, I can classify further into three types. What are they? That is, one is electron deficient hydrides. Electron deficient. Not obeying under rule. Then electron precise hydrides and electron rich hydrides. It is based on the availability of electrons. Pair. I can classify. Electron deficient, electron precise, and electron rich hydrides. Yeah. Okay, let me go one by one. First one, electron deficient hydrides. Let me discuss. What is this electron deficient hydrides? All elements of group 13, that is boron family, kindly follow. Boron, aluminium, gallium, indium, thallium, these elements generally form electron deficient hydride with the hydrogen because they will act as Lewis acid. They will act as Lewis acid. I have already discussed under the corresponding ionic equilibrium. Lewis acids, modern theory. That is, what is Lewis acid? Any substance which will always move towards electron will be called as Lewis acid. That's the interesting information. So, specific example here, boron, 2 moles, reacts with 3 moles of H2 gas to produce 2BH3 or B2H6, like borane. So this hydride, an electron deficient hydride, because if you take BH3, electronic configuration of boron is, that is 2s2 2p1, so only 3 electron in the outermost. So when they combine with the 3 hydrogen, means hydrogen again 1 electron, kindly follow here, let me, so 1 electron hydrogen, here again 1 electron hydrogen, here again 1 electron hydrogen. So outermost only 6 electron. So electron deficient. So this hydride, BH3 boron, is electron deficient. That is, it will be in the form of dimer. The interesting information. Okay. Let me go for the next one. Another is electron precise hydrides. Electron precise hydride generally formed from 14th group elements. All elements of group 14 form electron precise hydride with the hydrogen. That is carbon family. That is the carbon family. Carbon, silicon, that is the elements they will form. A specific example here, carbon combines with the 2 moles of hydrogen to produce methane. It's an hydride of carbon. Can you follow? This is electron precise, sufficiently satisfied. This compound, hydride, generally will have tetrahedral geometry. Tetrahedral geometry. This is geometry. Carbon here, hydrogen,
hydrogen and hydrogen, tetrahedron.
This is the interesting information regarding for electron precise hydride. Next one, third type is electron rich hydrides. Third type. So this electron rich hydride generally formed from group 15 to group 17. So all elements of group 15 to 17 form electron rich hydrides. They have excess electrons which are present as a lone pair. So 13th boron family, 14th carbon family, then 15th nitrogen family, then 16th oxygen family, and 17th fluorine family. So all that is starting from, that is the 15th family, nitrogen, oxygen and fluorine family. So these elements generally, when they form hydrides with hydrogen, they will be always having lone pair. So they will call it a electron rich hydrides. The interesting information, kinetic first one, ammonia formation. 1 mole of N2 reacts with the 3 moles of H2 to produce 2 moles of ammonia gas. So now ammonia, when you write the electronic configuration, kindly follow H. This is the formula, molecular formula. We will be writing one electron pair here. Because here already 2 electrons, here already 2 electrons, here already 2 electrons. So this lone pair readily available. We are calling it electron rich. The same way, when you go for oxygen, combines with 2 moles of hydrogen to produce water. Again, water I can write like this. H, O, H. Again, it is having 2 lone pairs in the electronic configuration. The same way, go for fluorine again. Hydrogen reacts with the fluorine to produce 2 HF. So, HF means I can write like this. This is the electronic configurations. So, kindly follow. In this case, again 8 electrons surrounding the fluorine. So, there are 3 lone pair. So, again rich. The rich in the electrons. So the interesting information is nitrogen family, oxygen family and fluorine family, when they form hydrides, they will call it as electron rich hydrides, because all these will behave as Lewis bases. Can you follow? Lewis bases. What is Lewis base? Any substance which will provide a lone pair will call it as a Lewis base. Ammonia is a Lewis base. So water is a Lewis base, HF is a Lewis correspondingly. So this is the interesting information. Let me go for the next one. Last one, that is metallic or non-stoichiometric hydrides. Non-stoichiometric hydrides. So normally D block and F block elements form metallic hydrides with the hydrogen. Can you follow? Alkaline, alkaline metal also metallic, but in that case it's a salt hydride. But in this case D block and F block, we are calling it as metallic hydride. Here it is important to note that metals of group 7, 8, 9 do not form hydrides. 7, 8, 9 do not form hydrides. So actually they are coming under the D block elements, transition elements. So these 7, 8 and 9 group do not form hydrides. They are non-stoichiometric, sometimes called interstitial hydrides. The interesting information. This is the most important information. So metallic or non-stoichiometric hydrides generally formed by the D block and F block elements. What is the non-stoichiometric? Stoichiometrically, the ratio will not be there. So, specific example, vanadium hydride. So, hydrogen is only 0.56%. Nickel hydride, 0.6 to 0.7%. Palladium hydride again, 0.6 to 0.8%. And titanium hydride, 1.5 to 1.8%. That is again zinc hydride 1.3 to 1.7%, and lanthanum hydride it is 2.85%, and that is the element having the symbol YB hydride corresponding to 2.5%. So this is the interesting information. Okay, let me go for the next one. So this is regarding for hydrogen. I have discussed so far regarding hydrogen. So let me go for the another isotope of hydrogen is deuterium. Let me concentrate. Kindly follow.
Deuterium is one of the isotopes of hydrogen, I have already discussed. Usually represented capital D, that is normally give 1s2. It is also known as heavy hydrogen. That is the interesting information. It is also known as heavy hydrogen. Normal hydrogen is protium, heavy hydrogen is deuterium. Okay, the deuterium was discovered and named by Harold Urey in 1931. A scientist, Harold Urey in 1931 discovered deuterium. The percentage of deuterium is only 0.0156 in total hydrogen compound found in the ocean. If you compare the total percentage, so total percentage, among the total percentage of hydrogen, so only 0.0156 percentage of deuterium is present. This is the interesting information regarding the occurrence. Now, what are the methods we can prepare deuterium? As you found out, methods of preparation. There are three methods commonly we are using to prepare deuterium. Number one, by diffusion process. Number two, fractional distillation of liquid hydrogen. Number three, electrolysis of heavy water. So here I need not give still more explanation. Let me explain this way. Diffusion means what? Diffusion by simply pass a mixture of hydrogen gas. The hydrogen gas, if you pass by diffuse through a vessel, what will happen? Now hydrogen protium will be faster here, that the deuterium will be smaller, slower. So by this technique, diffusion technique, we can separate deuterium from hydrogen protium. By fractional distillation of liquid hydrogen, so liquid hydrogen, if you distill by fractionating, using fractionating column, again we can separate deuterium. And finally, take heavy water, D2O, and pass electric current, again you will get D2. Deuterium we can get. So these are the three methods we can prepare deuterium properties. Coming for the deuterium, I have to discuss physical and chemical properties. I will discuss. First, let me take physical properties. Deuterium is a colorless, odorless, and tasteless gas, like protium, which is insoluble water, again, as in the case of protium. So, deuterium is a colorless, odorless, and tasteless gas, which is insoluble water. And it is a bad conductor of heat and electricity. Another interesting information. When you compare to protium, the bond, that is the breaking of bond, is very, very more energy is required. Bond energy is more. So generally, it's a bad conductor of heat and electricity. The next one. Coming for chemical properties. When you compare the reactivity with the protium, deuterium is less reactive than protium. This is the one important comparison you must have it in mind. It is less reactive than protium. So let me discuss this way again. So first let me take action of non-metals, as in the case of protium. So under the non-metals, first let me take oxygen. So oxygen reacts with deuterium to produce D2O, heavy water. So heavy water, if you want to produce, simply you just heat with the O2 gas, the D2 will produce D2O heavy water. The next method. Action of halogens. Another non-metal. So under suitable conditions, it forms corresponding deuterium halides. This is the interesting information. Just like HBr, HI, this will form corresponding, instead of H, D will be there. That's the only difference. So for example, if you take deuterium and chlorine in presence of sunlight, it will form deuterium chloride is formed. DCl is formed, deuterium chloride. The same way, if you use fluorine, it is highly reactive comparatively. That means even in dark, it forms DF, deuterium fluoride it is formed. This is the interesting information I want to. So, in presence of light, chlorine reacts to prove correspondingly DCl. But in dark, even fluorine reacts even in dark to produce DF. So, when you are comparing, this I already discussed under the protium itself. So, fluorine is the most reactive, then comes chlorine, then comes bromine, then iodine. So, iodine will be less reactive comparatively. It reacts only in the presence of catalyst. This I have already, same thing applicable here also under deuterium. Then another interesting non-metal, nitrogen, action of nitrogen. Can you follow? So deuterium, 3 moles, reacts with 1 mole of N2 to form ND3, deuterioammonio or heavy ammonia. I will call it as heavy ammonia. So this is the very another interesting information. So nitrogen, non-metal nitrogen reacts with 3 moles of D2 deuterium to produce 2 moles of ND3, that is called deuterioammonia or heavy ammonia. This is the interesting information. Next one. Next, so far what I have discussed is the action of non-metals. The next let me go for action of metals. So like hydrogen, deuterium reacts with alkali metals at high temperature. The temperature is 633 Kelvin to form deuterides. Kindly follow. Exactly the reaction is similar that of hydrogen, that's the protium, dihydrogen. The only difference in reactivity is this is less reactive, deuterium is less reactive, whereas hydrogen is more reactive. So, like hydrogen, deuterium reacts with the alkali metal at a high temperature, that is 633 Kelvin, to form deuterides. A specific example here, 1 mole of D2 reacts with 2 moles of sodium gives sodium deuteride. So, if it is hydrogen, I will call it sodium hydride. In this case, I will call sodium deuteride. That's the only difference. Instead of sodium, I can even use lithium, I can use potassium, I can use rubidium, I can use cesium, anything. First group metal. Same way, second group metal I can use beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium and radium also I can use. This is the interesting information. Kindly follow. So like hydrogen, deuterium reacts with alkali metals at high temperature, that is 633 Kelvin, to form deuterate. Just now I have explained you. Okay, let me go for the next one. Action of compounds. What is a compound? I have already explained to you. Compound is different from the element. Element means only one type of atoms. Compound means minimum two different types of atoms. A specific example, sodium chloride is a compound. Sodium atom, chlorine atom, two different. Water, a compound. Methane, compound. But suppose O2, O3, they are all elements. Even though more than one atoms, they are elements. Okay, kindly follow. So, let me discuss under this action of compounds. First, let me discuss action of organic compounds. So, deuterium reacts with ethylene to produce correspondingly deuterated product. I can simply say undergoes reduction. The ordinary way, ethylene undergoes reduction with hydrogen to produce ethane. So, this is in this case, same way that ethylene undergo reduction with D2, that is the deuterium, that instead of hydrogen, deuterium is substituted. So that means, as in the case of ethylene, ethane, here the deuterated ethane, it is forming. Very interesting information. And most, just see here, methane and ethane also reacts with deuterium. 2 moles of D2 reacts with methane to produce CD3. Instead of methane, deuterated methane. 2 moles of hydrogen. Same way, D2, and then 2-3 moles of D2 reacts with ethane to produce deuterated ethane corresponding 3 moles of H2. In both cases, kindly see the interesting information is hydrogen is displaced by deuterium. Hydrogen is displaced by deuterium. This is the interesting information you must have. Kindly follow. So thus, deuterium undergo ready exchange with the hydrogen in the case of a number of compounds slowly, partially or completely high temperature. So at a high temperature, this is possible. Thus, deuterium undergo ready exchange with hydrogen in the case of a number of compounds slowly, partially or completely at high temperature. Just now I have shown you the interesting equation here. So in this case, kindly see, hydrogen is displaced by D and we are getting CD4. Same way in ethane, I can have 6 hydrogen atom displaced by 6 DD. Deuterium atom. So, simply it is displaying. This is happening only at a high temperature. This is the interesting information. Okay, the next one. Action of inorganic compounds. So far what I have discussed is
action of organic compound. Now let me take one or two examples. So what will happen to deuterium attacks on the inorganic compound? Specific example, action of ammonia. So under the action of ammonia, so ammonia reacts with deuterium to produce the corresponding heavy ammonia, deuterated ammonia. So 2 moles of NH3 reacts with 3 moles of D2 to produce 2 moles of NH3 and 3 moles of H2. So heavy ammonia we can prepare by using ammonia. Instead of hydrogen, you can use D2. It will simply displace. Very interesting information. Same way, action of water. Water also reacts with D2. We can say at a higher temperature, hydrogen will be again substituted by D. So D2O, that is heavy water, is formed from ordinary water by treating with D2, deuterium. So hydrogen will be displaced. See, all the reaction you can come across, hydrogen will be displaced by deuterium only at a higher temperature. This is the interesting information you must have. Okay, let's move to the next. Uses. What are the uses coming for the under the deuterium? And I have discussed already a number of uses under the protium, hydrogen, dihydrogen. So here, to study mechanism, we can apply deuterium. Kindly follow. This is a very, very interesting information. Because when we are going for organic reactions, organic mechanisms, so wherever there is a proton, protium, and the proton can be substituted by deuterium, then we can study the reaction, because the rate will be affected by the change of instead of hydrogen, if you substitute the deuterium, the rate will vary. So based on the rate difference, we can study the mechanism. So there, mechanism can be studied by deuterium. Then, in artificial radioactivity, again we can use deuterium. This is very interesting information. The third one, it is used as a moderator in the form of heavy water. So in the form of heavy water, deuterium in the form of heavy water, used as a moderator. This is a very, very interesting information, uses of deuterium. The next one. Let me go. The next, tritium, another isotope of hydrogen is tritium, usually represented by capital T or 1H⁻³. That is the symbol for tritium. Interesting information. This is actually most important and lesser quantity of isotope is present. So, Mark Oliphant discovered tritium in 1932. In 1932, Mark Oliphant discovered tritium. It is a rare isotope of hydrogen. Very, very rare. It is again, its traces are found in nature due to nuclear reaction induced by cosmic rays. So it is radioactive in nature. That's interesting information. So Mark Oliphant discovered tritium in 1932. It's a rare isotope of hydrogen. Its traces are found in nature due to nuclear reaction induced by cosmic rays available in the atmosphere. The next one. Next, I will discuss preparation of tritium. Tritium, you know the symbol 1H3, normally indicated by capital T. So there are a number of methods are available for the preparation of tritium. Here I have discussed only 2 methods. One is by bombarding lithium with the slow neutrons. So lithium having the atomic number 3, mass number 6, when it is bombarded with a neutron 0N1, so we are getting the tritium along with the helium nuclear. Helium. So this is the interesting information. The second method we can prepare tritium is by bombarding beryllium with the deuteron again. By beryllium with the deuteron, again we can get tritium. This is the second method. What way? So take beryllium, atomic number 4, mass number 9. So when it is bombarded with the deuterium, atomic number 1, mass number 2, we are getting tritium along with a beryllium nucleus. That is, in this case, mass number is 8. Another isotope. The same way. So, again, beryllium, atomic number 4 and mass number 9 isotope, when it is bombarded with, again, deuterium, now we are getting tritium and that is the moles of helium nucleus. So the interesting information is, we are starting with the same beryllium nucleus and again same deuteron, but two different reactions we are getting. The first case, along with the tritium, an isotope of beryllium, that is atomic number 4 and mass number 8, is formed. The second case, tritium along with the helium nucleus. This is the interesting information regarding the preparation of tritium. Let me go for the next one. Properties. It is the radioactive with a half-life period of 12.4 years. Kindly follow. It decays with helium 3 with the emission of beta radiation. This is the corresponding the radioactive disintegration. Tritium giving helium, the corresponding 3 and the emission of beta radiation. What is half-life period? So I must give, what is half-life period? So half-life period normally indicated by T half. In the case of first order reaction, T half is equal to 0.6932 divided by K. This is the T half, half-life period. T half nothing but half-life period. Right. So this is for first order reaction, T half is equal to 0.6932 divided by K. K is the rate constant for the first order reactions. You must know definition. What is half-life? It is the time required to convert the concentration to 50% of original. Suppose, let me take 1 gram, a sample. So, I have to wait until it converted to 0.5 gram. So, what time taken, whatever time taken to convert 1 gram to 0.5 gram, that time taken is called half-life period. It may be in seconds, it may be in minutes, it may be in hours, days, weeks, months, even years. So it is the time taken. So it is the time required to convert the 50% of the original to the convert the, it will reduce to the 100% to 50%. So 50% of the original will be decomposed, we'll call it as, that time required is called half-life period. Kindly follow. So in this case, for tritium, half-life period is 12.4 years. That is the interesting information. The next one. Coming for uses, the most only two important uses I have to discuss under the tritium. One is, tritium is used as a radioactive tracer in chemical research. In all chemical research, so tritium is used as a radioactive tracer. So another interesting information, it is used in nuclear fusion reaction. In all nuclear fusion reaction, we are using tritium. So these are the important uses of tritium. I hope you have enjoyed the lecture.